All right, I'm here with Mr. Tom Monaghan. It's a very great privilege for me and I think for my students to be able to talk with you. And I've submitted submitted a request for my students to ask you questions, and I have several of those. Also, looking at your history, Mr. Monaghan, there are a lot of interviews with you on YouTube, and I don't want to recover too much material that I think you've done a good job in answering. So there are a lot of ways we could go with this interview. Could probably speak for hours, but I'm going to start with this about your history in Jackson, because I teach at Jackson College, based in Jackson, Michigan. We have campuses in Adrian as well as Hillsdale, and then a lot online. But a lot of our students are in that central Michigan area, and with all the history I have in following you over the years, I didn't know until I met you a couple weeks ago that you actually grew up in a way in Jackson. So my first question would be, what are your memories of Jackson, and how did your experience there shape your life?
Well, very nostalgic memories of Jackson. I was there from 6 to 12.
Ages 6 through 12.
Yeah, that'd be 1943 to 1949.
All right.
And I lived at a place called St. Joseph's Home for Boys. It was a Catholic orphanage run by the Felician sisters, all Polish.
Ah.
And it was on Blackstone Street by the railroad track. It was torn down in, I think, 1967. I think the fire marshal condemned it.
Oh, really?
By that time, it was St. Joseph's Home for Children. They had boys and girls there. I think they added, the attic was huge, and I think they added another dorm for girls there.
About how many people were there when you were a resident?
I'd say about 50 boys, and probably about, I'd say, 8 nuns, and a priest and a janitor also lived there.
I see.
And one home that was built for a family of three.
Oh, my. So it was crowded, I imagine.
I don't think so. There was a lot of servants' quarters where the nuns lived.
Oh. Now, you had a brother, I understand. Was he also in the orphanage with you?
Yes. He was 2.5 years younger than I was, so he was in a different age group, so I didn't get to see a lot of them there.
Okay. So I'm sure there were a lot of influences there on your life. Anything that really sticks out in your mind as being... life-changing or life-shaping?
Well, it was very strict and very holy. And that would be a way of summing up what it was like. We had a lot of prayer. We had Mass and benediction every day. We had a lot of long morning prayer, long evening prayers. And there were Catholic symbols throughout the place, statues, pictures, everywhere. There's no doubt that the place was Catholic. And the sisters were very holy women, we heard about God a lot. It was like being brought up in a convent.
That could be good and bad, if I can be blunt. My mother was raised in Catholic schools and had negative experiences because she saw some hypocrisy. And it's encouraging to hear you say that given that there were several committed nuns there, you didn't see anything that really turned you away, it sounds.
Oh, no, there's nothing hypocritical about these nuns. They were holy women. As far as I'm concerned, it was all good. I mean, I didn't like it. I didn't like the strictness. I wanted to get out and be like other kids. For the last 4 years, I went to St. Mary's grade school. In fact, Dave Hill was in my class, the famous golfer.
Oh, really?
Yes.
So were you not living in the orphanage any longer?
I was living in the orphanage, but we left in the morning to go to school, and then we came back in the afternoon.
I see.
In the early grades, we had school right there through the second grade.
All right.
And in fact, I once beat Dave Hill in a match. It wasn't a golfing match, it was a boxing match.
Oh.
And we had a boxing event at St. Mary's, and I beat them up pretty good, but unfortunately they called it a tie.
Oh.
Which I don't understand, because he never laid a hand on me.
But I've never understood boxing judging. It just baffles me.
Well, he was pretty popular in the school, and his dad always hung around there, and so Dad came over afterward and congratulated me on a good fight. I thought to myself, yeah, I clobbered your son.
I didn't know you. Boxing was one of your
Well, in the Orphanage, they had a boxing instructor come in and train us. And I found out I had a good left jab.
Mm.
And that's very important in boxing.
Mm-hmm.
And we had a lot of sports in the we called it the home. It was mainly baseball, basketball, and football.
Mm-hmm.
I was clearing away the reigning ping pong champion in the Orphanage. I enjoyed all three of the sports, probably particularly basketball.
Now, I know you developed a love for baseball and eventually owned the Tigers. Did you start developing that love while in the Orphanage?
Oh, yeah, we were Tiger nuts in the Orphanage.
Mm.
We all had our favorite player. And the highlight of the year was when the Knights of Columbus and Jackson took us to Old Brigg Stadium to see a Tiger game.
Brigg
that was
Stadium.
The highlight of the year for us.
Mm-hmm.
And we knew all the staffs and everything. And the Lions weren't around then, or they were very insignificant.
I know they were around in the 50s. My mother would tell me they were actually good in the 50s. They haven't been good in my lifetime, but so this would be in the 40s. I don't know.
First time I heard of them was 49.
All right.
And of course, there weren't any Pistons. They were in Fort Wayne.
Mm. So the Tigers, was that the main team you'd follow as a boy?
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and the hockey we didn't know anything about because we didn't play hockey.
Mm.
The Red Wings were around.
Mm-hmm.
And we just all like Harry Heilman, the announcer. In fact, I could probably still quote the way he started out the game.
Mm.
And I thought he was the greatest announcer ever.
When did Ernie Harwell start? Do you remember?
He came, the next one after Ernie was Van Patrick.
Mm.
And Ernie Harwell was brought in by George Kell to cover part of the games with him.
Okay, and I know Ernie was there when you owned the Tigers. Mm-hmm. We might get to that. While we're still on Jackson, were there any influences in the community other than at the Orphanage? You mentioned you went to this other school, Dave Hill. You got to know Dave Hill. But was there anything particular you remember about Jackson that was memorable?
Well, we were kind of like in a prison.
Mm-hmm.
When we walked to school, we had to take a certain route. We couldn't stop anywhere. We weren't allowed to have money anyhow.
Mm.
And so we know that route real well. But when we'd go to a camp every summer for a week, which was a great thing. It was in Crispell Lake. And it's since burned down.
Oh.
But that was a big treat for us. And after Labor Day, we'd go to a resort on, I think it was either Clark Lake or Pleasant Lake.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And they had a dance hall there and a ping pong table there.
Ah.
So, and we had, they took a horizon what we called speed boats. These were the mahogany runabouts.
Mm-hmm.
That was a big thrill. We used to go to El Sharp Park a lot.
Okay.
See the zoo and the huge slides and play baseball.
Mm-hmm.
I went to YMCA camp. I think that was on Mill Lake towards Chelsea.
There's still a camp, a store camp near Napoleon. So it would be south of Chelsea. I don't know if it's the same one.
It wouldn't be it.
Okay.
And then there was one on Wolf Lake. That was a Boy Scout camp. Went there one summer.
Mm-hmm.
And we had Boy Scouts. We had Mr. Peck, who worked for the railroad, come in the regular base. Then we had the band. We had Mr. Hoffman that came in once a week, I think every Tuesday. And we had the band that night. And I played with an E-flat alto horn, which is like this.
What kind of horn is that? I'm going to try to pan if I can with my poor camera skills, but I played trumpet when I was in middle school. What would you call that?
That's an E-flat. We call them alto.
An alto.
But they use French horns now for the same
piece. Mm-hmm.
Oh. This is officially an E-flat alto horn. And I have one in Michigan, one in Florida, and I play it. This one doesn't play.
Oh.
This was.
But you still play?
Well, I just started up again about 15 years ago.
Okay.
And I also play a trumpet now, too.
Very cool.
Yeah, I guess I can play any horn with three fingers in it.
A lot of what we talk about in our class is, you know, creativity and starting new businesses. And there's been some research to indicate that studying music actually helps develop the brain and creativity. I don't know if you've ever thought about that, if your love of music and your practice of it has actually helped your development and creativity.
Well, I don't know if I had that much music. I left the orphanage when I was 12, and that's when I stopped playing.
Okay.
I ran across one of these at an antique show, and I bought it and restored it, not this one, another one, and I got a fingering chart, and I started to playing it. My wife wouldn't let me play in the house, so I had to go out on a tennis court.
I know, and you're just learning from experience. It can sound pretty dreadful.
Prefer to get a sound on it first.
Mm-hmm.
And now I memorized about 20-some songs.
Oh, fantastic.
And, I have a Reader's Digest songbook, and my favorite is Stardust.
I saw that you spend most of your time in a small dorm room in Ave Maria down in Florida. Do you play there?
We also had a house in Naples, and I had the horns there.
Okay. Do you have students right next to you in the dorm room?
Not real close. Mm. I was in a wing with some priests, and I actually was in a girls' dorm, but the girls weren't real close.
Okay. Probably a pretty quiet place,
then. I had a private. I came in the back entrance, and my room was right by the back entrance, so I...
All right. So much that we can cover here. Just a lot of students asked about what were some positive and negative influences in childhood, it's particularly it drove you to maybe want to start a business or positively affected you in starting a business. Was there anything that really comes to mind?
It seems like there's something I've always thought about doing. I remember in the orphanage playing the store.
Mm.
and trying to create a little store but it was silly. But I think
what would you sell, I'm wondering, in an orphanage? You didn't have any money.
What it was. No money. I just set up a counter with some blocks. That's not a real good example. When I got out of the orphanage, I lived there with our mother for a year. I put in a garden and I grew vegetables and I took them around door to door and sold them.
Mm.
I built a rabbit hutch and I raised rabbits.
Mm.
And the idea of making money on selling them, I couldn't bear to kill them, so I didn't make any money.
Mm.
But I was always when I got to where I was living in a senior year when I came to live with an aunt in Ann Arbor, my uncle gave me an old Jeep and I put an ad in the paper and I went around doing odd jobs for people.
Mm.
And when I was a kid in Traverse City, when it snows, we go around with a shovel and a broom and knocking on doors. There was always that instinct to make money.
So I'm going to ask you a hard question, which I don't know if anyone's answered, but it's the nature versus nurture question. In particular, many people who become very successful grew up in poverty or near poverty, as certainly you did. And so there's an argument that it's the environmental factor that you don't want to live like this the rest of your life. You want your children to have a better life. That's very common. But then there's also a major school of thought that say most of behavior is inborn, genetic, and it was just in the cards for you that you wanted to be successful, that you wanted to make money. Tough question, I know, but which one would you say is more true in your life? Do you think that your austere beginning made you want to do better, or are you just born to be an entrepreneur?
I'm definitely am a born entrepreneur.
Okay.
By instinct. And I tend to think long term. I'm seeing stuff out there that others don't see, I think.
Mm-hmm.
I've always been a big daydreamer.
Mm.
And when I was in the orphanage and after, when I got to the orphanage, I spent some of the first year we lived with my mother. in Traverse City. Mm-hmm. That just didn't work out.
Mm-hmm.
She couldn't handle two boys. She mm-hmm. was a very emotional type of woman.
Mm-hmm.
And so I went to live in foster farms. And I enjoyed the farm work. I went in the 10th grade, I went to seminary. And I got kicked out.
Was this in Vancouver, did I read?
No, I was living in Traverse City then.
Mm-hmm.
My mother went up there because she had hay fever.
Mm.
And she worked at Munson Hospital. She was a nurse.
Mm.
And then so when I went to seminary, I was in what was then the Grand Rapids Diocese, now a Gaylord Diocese, been added. So went to a seminary in Grand Rapids.
Seminary as a 10th grader in high school?
Yes, in those days you went in the 9th grade. Most,
oh, you did?
Yes.
Well.
Yeah, you went, and I was should have went in the 9th grade, but I was so interested in girls. And I've always wanted to be a priest until in the 7th grade. That's where I sat behind this girl in school.
I heard an interview with that the other day. I thought that was very funny, and
it was.
I wish we had more time. It seemed that early in life, and I think possibly the influences in the orphanage, you want to be a priest. You sat behind a girl in 7th grade, and as you know, when boys, the hormones start kicking in, and you didn't want to be a priest anymore. But that didn't last, obviously, because by 10th grade, you were committed again. You wanted to be a priest.
Yeah, I said, I got to do what I'm supposed to do, and I got to get over this thing with girls.
Mm-hmm.
I was really girl crazy, but I was too shy to do anything about it. And I think a lot of the shyness was because of the way I was living. And I wasn't like other kids. In those days, everybody had a mother and father.
Mm-hmm.
And I was different.
And just so it's clear, your father died when you were 4, is that right?
Yes.
And then, of course, you said your mother had some emotional problems and put you in the orphanage for a while. So you had a mother, but you were never very close to her.
No, she was a good woman,
mm-hmm.
and I've always felt that. But she was sort of on a different wavelength. She was brilliant.
Mm-hmm.
I believe she was top in her class in high school.
Mm-hmm.
And she went to school. She went to your school. She went to Jackson Junior College.
Oh, she did?
She took so many classes there.
Oh,
she
my goodness.
Always, she loved school.
Ah, fascinating.
Yeah. But I forgot what you were asking.
Well, there's so many directions we could go in. While we're here, I had one student ask, in the food industry in particular, because a lot of my students want to start restaurants, and I know it's a very difficult business. My mother actually was the daughter of German immigrants who started the Cottage Inn in Ann Arbor, I'm sure you're familiar with. Now it's a pizza place, but it was a German restaurant back during the Depression. And those were my parents. And then my granddad died in 1941, so grandma and my mom and her sisters ran it for about 20 years. But mom would always say, the restaurant business is so difficult. I'm going to say at least a third of my students want to start restaurants. So I had some of them ask, what advice would you give to someone who wants to start a restaurant?
Well, I don't know what the stats are today, but when I was in business years ago, the numbers were something like 90% of restaurants were a failure after the first year.
That's about right.
And but with franchising, they were something like 90% successful.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, that was our pitch, trying to people to franchise.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't make that up. That was came from somewhere. I want to respond to your earlier question. You talked about when I was a kid, I was so embarrassed of my situation.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't like being in the orphanage. I liked not being able to be like other kids with a family and all the things they did that we couldn't do. And when I got out of the orphanage and the foster farms, I didn't like to live in an environment that was very different than the other kids. And I didn't have any money. I had old, threadbare clothes. But I was thinking about what I was going to do when I grew up. When I can control my life, I'm going to do something about it. And that was my mindset.
Mm-hmm.
So that might have something to do with why I was able to do the things I did. I don't know.
Mm-hmm. So I'm seeing two things. That determination to control your life, because much of your early life you had to rely on others, and then just your ability to think ahead, to look toward the future.
And another thing is I'm competitive by nature.
Mm.
I'm a, I'm a much better athlete than I'm gifted to be.
Mm.
A lot of it's because of just the hustle and attitude.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that in business, you don't have the physical limitations.
Mm. I had one student ask, do you ever relax? Because as we briefly studied your life, we only had a few days to prepare, so students did an overall summary of your life. And it's been one thing after another, and of course you had this, I'm going to almost say epiphany in the late 80s when reading C.S. Lewis's Mere Christianity, which really changed, I think, the course of your life and more emphasis on charitable causes, but you're still a very busy man. So one student asked, did you ever get a point in your life where you just could relax?
Well, I've always got goals that I set that I'm working on. And you know, do I relax? I don't know if I want to relax.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I enjoy playing the game.
Mm-hmm.
I never wanted to come out of a basketball game in my life.
Ah.
I mean, I just want to play.
So it seems that you enjoy, you get an excitement from being involved in new ventures and in building things.
Well, when I had Drummond Island, probably one of the most enjoyable things I've ever done.
Could you explain a little bit what that is, Drummond Island?
Drummond Island was a lodge up in northern Lake Huron on Drummond Island.
Mm-hmm.
And it was kind of a labor of love building that, and I'm a frustrated architect.
Mm-hmm.
And then a championship golf course and a hotel and put in a whole water treatment facility.
Oh, you built a resort up there.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And every time I couldn't wait to go up there, and I always hated to leave. I didn't vacation anywhere else in the years I've owned that. And whether it's winter or summer, about at least one weekend a month. What did I do when I go up there? I'd get out sketches and drawing plans and.
Mm-hmm.
And working on the projects up there. I just love that.
Mm-hmm.
It was, turned out to be kind of foolish because I had to practically give the place away when I sold it because it's just so remote.
Go ahead, I'm sorry.
So one thing I enjoy doing now, I think, that you could call relaxation is go out to dinner in the evening with my wife and some friends.
Mm-hmm.
And have a nice meal and a glass or two of wine. I think I enjoy that as much as anything.
Very good.
And I do that two or three times a week.
This idea of passion is something we talk a lot about in our course. There's been a lot of research to indicate that passion is the most important thing. If you're going to start a business, you have to really be passionate because we know it's going to be difficult. There will be days when you want to quit. Obviously, you also need good planning and resiliency and a lot of the things that you've embodied. But clearly, you're a passionate man. You've done a lot of things that you've been passionate about. You love to build. But then some people are asking, why pizza? Not a lot of folks wake up in the morning and say, I'm passionate about pizza. What drove you into the pizza business?
It was purely accidental. My brother was a mailman, and you probably heard the story if you checked me out. And he used to stop at Dominic's Pizza in Ann Arbor every day for lunch.
Was this the one down by the business school on campus? It's still there today?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And they became friends, and they're both characters.
Mm.
And Dominic had a place in Ypsilanti that closed.
Mm-hmm.
It was probably open a month or two. And to try to sell my brother on it.
Mm.
My brother was interested in doing it, but he didn't want to do it alone. So he came to me and asked me if I'd go in with him on it. And I felt, well, I was temporarily out of school. I was trying to work about three jobs to raise some money to get back in the school.
So you had been studying architecture at University of Michigan?
Well, I was in my freshman year.
All right.
So I wasn't studying much. I went to Michigan for 3 weeks.
Oh, my.
And then I dropped out because I scraped up enough money for tuition, but I didn't have any money for textbooks. So I went to school 3 weeks without textbooks.
Mm.
I figured this is ridiculous. So I dropped out for a semester.
Mm.
And then I worked my tail off in a number of jobs and went back next semester. And and I was working so many hours, I couldn't stay awake in class.
Mm.
And so her wife dropped out again, and then next the following year. By this time, I'm 23 years old and still a freshman.
So you had been in the Marines at this point? Okay.
Yeah. And that's another story. I joined the Marine Corps because the recruiter told me I'd get 2 years of college all paid for by joining for 3 years.
Mm.
I was put in the infantry. I had the second highest GCT in my outfit, and they put me in the infantry.
Mm.
So I didn't get any schooling there. But I did save most of the money I made in the Marine Corps.
They didn't live up to their promise of if you were in for 3 years, you'd get tuition paid?
No.
That's surprising. They had the GI Bill back then, didn't they?
No, I was in between Korea and Vietnam. When I got out of the Marine Corps, I didn't have the GI Bill, or I'd be an architect today.
Oh, my gosh. Oh.
It became available to me sometime after, but by that time I was stuck in the pizza business and I really couldn't go to school.
Mm. Oh, well, that's disappointing that you
It turns out that it was a good thing.
You did all right.
I'd be an architect if I had the GI Bill.
Uh-huh. Interesting. Mm. All right, so out of necessity, this opportunity presented itself. You jumped in with your brother. Your story is fascinating.
It was supposed to be a situation where I'd work half the night, he'd work half the night, then I'd be able to have time to go to school.
Mm-hmm.
And my brother, after we signed the papers, got cold feet and couldn't give up his security of his post office job, so I was stuck with running the place, and there went school.
Mm-hmm.
I remember hearing recently you said you went 6 months without a break, and then you said to your brother, I need one night off. And he gave you one night off, and I don't know if you want to share a little bit of what happened after that.
Yeah, the next night he came in and said he wanted out.
Mm, too much work in just one night.
He just said he thought it was something that he wasn't interested in, and I was good at it.
Mm.
So, he didn't want any money, and of course it wasn't worth anything. The bills were piling up, So I said, well, you did take a risk. I should give you something, even though I don't have anything. Then I thought if we just had bought a used Volkswagen and paid $100 down or something for delivery. And I said, you take the Volkswagen, I'll keep making the payments. And I think it was $800. That's what I bought him out with.
And the humor there, and I've heard you tell this story, I think 30 years ago was the first time, and I loved it. Weren't you the one that came up with the idea, if we could deliver, you're near Eastern Michigan University, if we could deliver it, say, to the dorms, that might be a good angle. And it turned out to be tremendous that you were selling a lot of pizzas by doing free delivery. But then you gave away the one vehicle you had. And I know when you tell that, everybody laughs, but I don't remember. How did you overcome that? It seemed that you were in a real tough situation.
Your employees had cars and you used their cars.
Okay.
To pay the mileage.
So people would have to have a car in order to work for you, at least as a delivery person.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Very good. And so I know fairly quickly you started expanding. And how did you get this idea to...